In this video, we will talk about dimensions and units. All physical quantities have a few attributes, starting with name or symbol, value. So if it's a scalar quantity, there'll be just a number. If it's a vector quantity, you will also have direction, dimensions, units, as well as significant digits. And each of these five attributes are important when you specify a measurement or you write value of a scalar or a vector quantity. So name or symbol is fairly straightforward. If you want to indicate the velocity or a force, you need to have a symbol. Let's say V for velocity, force for force. If you have a scalar quantity, let's say mass, you would use M. So these are basically the symbols, or you can give them full name also. And you need to specify some value for them as well. Now, what about dimensions? Let's discuss dimensions now. Both dimensions and units, both of these attributes specify some quality of the measurement. Dimensions specify what we call an abstract quality of a measurement without specifying a numerical value. So for example, if let's say I have a circle, or I have a line, or I have the height of a person, or even let's say the circumference of a ball. Okay, radius, the length, the height, and I'm using some symbols over here, and let's say the circumference is given as P for you. There is something common to all of these four measurements. What is common is that they all have same dimension, and that dimension is length. See, we did not specify a number when we talk about the dimensions over here. Now, the dimensions are very few, so you can see that for all of these four different physical quantities, we have the same dimensions. There are what we call fundamental dimensions, also known as basic dimensions, which there are very few. And then you also have derived dimensions. You have derived dimensions. So some of the fundamental dimensions are length, and in short, we will write it as L, mass, M, time, T. You also have temperature, which we will not have to deal with much in this class, the temperature. We will write it as theta, as well as current, which we can write as, let's say, I, or, you know, sometimes you could write it as I as well. Derived dimensions are dimensions of the quantities that are derived or obtained from fundamental or base dimensions. So for example, area is one physical quantity which can be defined as length times width. And of course, both length and width have the same dimension. So the dimension of, let me write it as D, dimension of area is L squared, or length squared. Cube, dimension of a cube, or let's say volume of a cube, would be L cube. Dimension of velocity would be defined as distance traveled over time, the average velocity. So the dimension would be L over T, or written as L times T power minus 1. Okay, so these are, you know, derived dimensions, and there are quite a few derived dimensions out there. Pretty much every physical quantity can be expressed in terms of its base dimensions. But then there are physical quantities that don't have any dimensions also. So there are dimensionless quantities. So dimensionless quantities. For example, Mach number. So what is Mach number? Mach number is defined as the speed of an object divided by the speed of the sound. Now, since the numerator and denominator have the same physical quantity, clearly the Mach number is a dimensionless quantity. Or for that matter, angle. So angle is defined as arc length divided by the radius. So for example, if you have, let's say, a quarter circular arc, then S is equal to 2 pi r over 4. And in that case, the angle, this theta, would be equal to 2 pi r over 4 divided by r. And that will give you basically what, pi by 2, right? So that's the angle. So clearly, this is also a dimensionless quantity because S has the units of length, R has the units of length. Now, of course, sometimes people say this is in degree or radians, but degree or radians are actually not units. That's just a way for us to say that we are talking about angles. Another example for dimensionless quantity would be chemis mole. So chemis mole is defined as the number of molecules, in a substance divided by Avogadro number, right? So Avogadro number, then both of them are same quantity in the numerator and denominator. So they are, you know, both dimensionless quantities. Trigonometric function, how about them? Trigonometric function. So trigonometric function are sine, cosine, and so on. And they're all defined as angles. So let's say we have a right angle triangle, and this is an angle theta, then sine theta is defined as, let's say this is A, this is B, and this is C, is defined as A over C, and clearly A and C, both of them are have the units of length. So trigonometric functions are also dimensionless quantities. Now let's talk about units. So units they specify a relative quality of a measurement with respect to a chosen scale. Now, there are quite a few scales available out there. We will talk about two major unit systems in this class. One is called USCS system. So USCS system. So USCS, the full form is US customary system. And the other one is called SI system, which is an abbreviation of actually a French word. So SI system and USCS system are, you know, two primary unit systems that we will be dealing with. Sometimes people call USCS system an English or FPS system. FPS stands for foot pound second, because those are the primary units in the US system. So when you talk about the length, foot is the unit that is chosen for the length, and pound is chosen for the weight or the mass. And second, of course, is same for both SI and USCS system. SI system is also called MKS system, which stands for meter kilogram second, or metric system. So metric system. So different names, and there is quite a bit of history associated with both the system. Unfortunately, we do have to know both the systems fairly well, because for historical reasons, people have been continuing to use one of the unit system over another one, even though now the push is to adopt the SI system uniformly across the world so that world trade can continue without any hindrance, or, you know, without causing any confusion over as to what numbers are you reporting with respect to, you know, which unit. So in both USCS system and SI system, the basic dimensions are expressed differently. So in USCS system, length is in terms of foot. Mass, there are two units in USCS system. One is called slugs or pound mass. So this is how we write it, pound mass. LBM is a pound mass. And time is second, okay? In SI system, the length is in terms of meter, mass is in terms of kilogram, and time is in terms of second. One of the major difference between the US system and SI system is that in USCS system, mass is actually not a fundamental unit. Mass is a fundamental unit in SI system. So in USCS system, instead of mass, actually is the force that's a fundamental unit. So in USCS system, force has a unit of pound, or also known as or written as pound force. Okay, so now to understand this critical difference between the two USCS system, we have to look at Newton's second law. So Newton's second law says that force applied on a particle or an object is equal to its mass times its acceleration. So I have a particle over here, and there is a certain force applied on it, and its mass is A. As a result, it experiences some acceleration, A. And the force, mass, and acceleration are related via the second law applied in a Newtonian or inertial reference frame. So now we substitute some of our units from the SI system and USC system and see what we get. So we know that mass is a fundamental unit in the SI system, and acceleration can be written in terms of fundamental dimension as well. So the units which we'll have over here would be kilogram, and this will be meters per second squared, right? And 1 kilogram meter per second squared is defined as 1 newton. So 1 newton is equal to 1 kilogram meters per second squared. Now you can also write it in terms of dimensions. So in terms of dimensions, we would write it as ML over T squared, or ML times T power minus 2. So keep in mind that anytime I say, please do the dimension analysis, instead of writing the units, which there are quite a few, you would actually use these symbols, MLT, to do all the analysis. Later on, when we start talking about dimensional homogeneity, dimensional verification of equations and formulas, I will ask you to do the dimensional verification using the symbols. So please don't use the units in that case. So the dimension of the force in SI system is ML T power minus 2. And Newton is a derived unit. So in this case, force has our unit as Newton or kilogram meter per second squared. And force is a derived unit. Now let's look at it from the perspective of the USC system, where we know that force is a fundamental unit, but mass is not. So let's write F equal to M times A once again. So in USC system, force unit is pound force. So let's write pound force on the left-hand side, which is a base unit. Right-hand side, mass. Okay, mass is something that will be derived. So we'll write it M. Acceleration would be foot per second squared. Okay, so now in this case, we find that the unit of the mass, we'll define it in a minute, is pound force times second squared over feet. This is defined as one slug in USC system. So slug happens to be a... Another way of looking at the same thing is that if you have a particle of mass one slug, and if it accelerates at acceleration of 1 feet per second squared, then the force applied on it is defined to be 1 pound force. So 1 pound force is equal to one slug times feet per second squared. So in that sense, the role that kilogram is playing over here is the role being played by slug over here, right? So we have a sort of equivalence. So we have USCS here, and then we have SI system, okay? And then we have the unit of mass over here as slug, and that role is being played by the unit of mass in SI system as kilogram. So think of them almost as sort of equivalent, okay? So 1 kilogram mass produces 1 newton of force when the object is accelerated at 1 meter per second squared. If one slug of mass is accelerated at 1 feet per second squared, that produces a force of 1 pound force, or simply as 1 pound. Now, the confusion arises when you start talking about pound mass, or simply the pound. So for example, you say that I'm going to go to the grocery store and buy 5 pounds of apple, right? So let's write it. So example, so buy 5 pound of apples. What does it mean? What is 5 pound? Is that pound force? Is that pound mass? So that's a little bit confusing, okay? So there are two things that you have to remember, two facts. Okay, so let me write that, and I'm going to use red color. So fact number one is that 1 pound mass of anything weighs 1 pound force. Notice I said weighs. So the weight of 1 pound mass of anything is equal to 1 pound force. I didn't say 1 pound mass is equal to 1 pound force. That would be actually wrong, because one is mass, the other is force, and the two are completely different quantities, right? So you cannot say that. So that's fact number two. Fact number one. The fact number two is that if you have 1 pound force applied on an object of one slug mass, then if it's accelerated at 1 feet per second squared, then this relationship would be valid. Okay? And this we have seen before as well, so this isn't anything new. So now, from this, we can clearly see that one slug is equal to 1 pound force times second squared over feet. And we can stop writing 1 over here. So slug is actually equal to pound force times second squared over feet. Okay. So this is coming from fact number 2. This is coming from fact number 2. We haven't used fact number 1. So let's use the fact number 1 now. So fact number 1 says 1 pound mass weighs 1 pound force. Okay. So what is the weight? Weight is defined as mass of something times gravitational acceleration. So 1 pound force is equal to 1 pound mass from this fact, and gravitational acceleration in foot second is given as 32.2 feet per second squared. Okay, so let's bring feet per second squared on the left hand side. I get 1 pound force times second squared over feet equal to 1 pound mass divided times 32.2. Okay, now what is this quantity over here? Compare it with this. This is the same as slug. So what we are getting is one slug is equal to 32.2 pound mass. That's the relationship between the slug and the pound mass. Now notice, I told you before that the mass has two units in USCS system, pound mass and slug. And this relationship over here tells you exactly how the two are related. Okay, now let's go back to our example. So our example was, we have to buy 5 pounds of apple. Now, what is that pound over there? Well, that pound could be pound force, it could be pound mass. And that's not a problem because 1 pound mass weighs same as 1 pound force. So ideally speaking, you should say buy 5 pound mass of apples or buy 5 pound force of apples. But this is something that people have been, you know, saying for a long time. And as long as we understand what it means, everything else is okay. So the thing to remember from all of this is that anytime you have to use the Newton's second law, F equal to ma, and you are operating in the USCS system of units, then the mass should always be plugged in slugs. So here is another example. So let's say there is a car. I know it doesn't look like a car, but you know, let's say you have a car. This is accelerating at 20 feet per second squared, and its mass is 33,000 pound mass. Okay. And the question is, what is the force applied on it that would give rise to the 20 feet per second squared acceleration? So don't write F equal to ma and plug in mass as 3000. Okay, that would be a mistake because this mass is expected to be in slugs in the USCS system. So this would be wrong. So what we have to do is we have to convert this 3000 pound mass into the slug. We know that one slug is equal to 32.2 pound mass from here. And that means that in slug, this would be 3000 divided by 32.2. Now that's in slugs, times acceleration as 20 feet per second squared. And you do this calculation, and I'm not going to do that. Whatever the numerical value would be, times would be slugs feet per second squared, which can also be written as pound force. Okay. Now in SI system, when you do these calculations, for computing the force or acceleration in F equal to ma, the mass has to be in kilogram. Acceleration has to be in meters per second squared. Then your answers will come out to be in Newton.